I want to acknowledge this morning that you're going to need to strap on your time travel shoes because we're going way back before the time of Jesus. So from today, something like 3,400 years ago before today, something happened in the life of Israel that's important for us to engage as we prepare and sort of set the table, set the stage for what Jesus is going to be speaking to us today. So these words from Exodus 32. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain. Now let me tell you what was going on here. Before this little scene is described, we know that God's people, the 12 tribes of Israel, were held as slaves in Egypt for some 400 years. They cried out for God's deliverance. God sent Moses to be that deliverer. So Moses came and said to Pharaoh so many times, "Let my people go." Pharaoh hardened his heart, and God sent plague after plague after plague against the Pharaoh's house and the Egyptians. And eventually, they let them go, the Israelites, and They come up against the edge of the Red Sea, and God opens up the waters and leads them across the Red Sea, and Pharaoh chases after, and the waters come rushing in and destroy Pharaoh. And there on the other side of the Red Sea, God makes his will, his blueprint for life known to Moses and through Moses to the people in what we call the Ten Commandments. God made that known. So scroll ahead just a little bit from that time. Moses goes back up on the mountain, and he's having more interaction and communication with the Lord. And here in Exodus 32, where it says, "When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they were tempted in that sense of not having their time schedule met." They were tempted with an idea that they needed to create an idol because they wanted a God that they could see and that they could touch. And here, Moses wasn't here to mediate that relationship anymore. Now think about this. They had seen God in their own living memory do the most spectacular intervention, the most spectacular deliverance of bringing an entire nation of people across the Red Sea, and they lived with that memory, and yet they could not be patient. I would like to think that if I were at the base of Mount Sinai and Moses had gone up to talk with the Lord, I would be saying, "Moses, take all the time you need. We know how God operates. We want to be on his side. Take all the time you need." And that's not what happened. They created this idol. And this is oftentimes the image of idolatry that comes to mind when we speak about idolatry, that there is worship before a golden calf, right? That's what was going on here in this story. And that really leads me to wonder, knowing that when we look at these stories in the Old Testament, that it shows us something about God and it shows us something about ourselves, it makes me wonder, when life doesn't meet our wants and our expectations, in what ways do we become idolatrous? In what ways do we look to things or experiences or people to do for us what only God can do for us? Because whenever we are reaching for something other than God, it's that same spiritual DNA that was present in Exodus 32 when they crafted this golden statue. Maybe we're not making statues like they did, but there's that same temptation within us to reach after something, right? And it's to that part of our humanity that I sense God is speaking to us today. We are in the sermon series that we are working through Mark's gospel. The sermon series, Follow the Leader. Jesus is our rabbi, in reading chapter after chapter, working our way through Mark's gospel. We are joining that circle of 12 disciples gathered around Jesus, seeking to learn from Jesus, his teaching, seeking to follow his example. And so far in the ground that we've covered in this book, Mark's gospel identifies itself as good news, because in Jesus, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, is breaking into planet Earth, and Jesus has identified himself as the healer and a teacher. Jesus is the all-powerful one who can take hopeless situations and turn them around. Jesus is the developer of people. He's called these 12 not only to follow along as his students, but now he's passing the baton of ministry over to them, and they are starting to do the same ministry that he is doing. We've seen Jesus, the shepherd of the heart. He doesn't want us merely to honor him with our lips, but he wants our hearts to draw close to him and as disciples. And more ground that we've covered. Jesus is the one who invites us to the cross. If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me, Jesus said. Jesus is the belief builder. This is the story we talked about last week, the father with the epileptic son. The father said, "I believe, help my unbelief." And Jesus was responding to his faith journey of coming to a place in his belief and saying, "Help me take that next step in belief," and Jesus blessing that with a miracle. And today, we see Jesus, the idolatry warrior, because he knows that as disciples of Jesus, if we're going to be effective in following Jesus, we cannot be bringing with us this propensity, this tendency on our part to be drawn to idolatrous behavior. So let's unpack this. We're looking at Mark 10. And I will tell you that it may appear that there are two separate little units or stories that are right next to one another in Mark's gospel. I think that they're related, and so we're going to read both of these this morning. But listen for the word of God. It's found on page 1570 in your pew Bible if you'd like to follow. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." And he took the children in his arms, put his hands on them, and bless them. So you've got the scene. Let me pause right here a second. The disciples are there. People want to bring their kids. The disciples first say, "Hey, get those kids out of here." And Jesus says, "No, bring them here." So we've got the disciples here. I'm in my mind's eye with the kids are here. And then something happens right after that. As Jesus started on his way, so he's like getting up out of his chair, something happens. A man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone." And let me just pause here a second. Because oftentimes as rabbis are interacting with their disciples, there's like a ping pong match of questions and answers, and a little bit of verbal sparring that's going on. And that's kind of what's going on here in this interaction. "No one is good except God alone," Jesus said. "You know the commandments. Do not murder. Do not commit adultery. Do not steal. Do not give false testimony. Do not defraud. Honor your father and mother." What are those commandments, by the way, that he's talking about? It's the Ten Commandments, but it's not all of them, is it? He's only talking about the second part, the second half of the Ten Commandments. And this is significant because the second part of the Ten Commandments has to do with our relationships with one another. The first half of the Ten Commandments has to do with our relationship with God as our King, God as our Lord. And so there, in essence, Jesus sees something in this man that needs to get out on the table. And the guy thinks that he's doing okay in his relationships with other people. Jesus discerns that he's not doing so good in this relationship with the Lord. And so there's this sparring, this little verbal sparring that's going on. The man's reply is, "Teacher, all these I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. Pay attention to that verse because we're going to come back to it. It is out of a sense of love that Jesus has this conversation with him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." Now let's just pause there a second. The man has walked away. The disciples are standing there. Jesus addresses the disciples, it says. "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." Now look what happens. The disciples were amazed at his words. But Jesus said again, now addressing these kids who were there. Because remember, people were bringing all their kids to Jesus. Jesus addresses the children, sort of looking at that man walking away, using him as an object lesson. "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Peter said to him, "We have left everything to follow you." "I tell you the truth," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or friends, fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, and with them persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life." But then Jesus said, "Many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." I think if we're going to unpack what God is up to here in this passage, let me say what Jesus is not saying. I don't believe Jesus is saying that there's a new way to eternal life, and that is by following the Ten Commandments. Jesus is not saying that, even though it may sound like that if you look at just that beginning foray into this conversation. Jesus is not saying, "Go out and follow the Ten Commandments, and God will welcome you into eternal life." The overarching witness of the Scriptures is calling us to belief and to have faith and surrender our lives to Jesus. That's the overarching message of the Bible. But Jesus discerns something going on here. So this is where the conversation starts. He's not laying out a new path to eternal life. And he's not saying that this prescription is normative. What does he say to the man? He says, "Sell all your possessions, give to the poor, and then come and follow me." He doesn't say that this is not only true for you, but it's true for everybody. Because Jesus saw something going on in this man's life and in his heart, and so he said to him, "Because of who you are, because of this battle that's going on in your own soul, this is the prescription for you." When you look at all that the Bible teaches us, God wants us to work and to be productive, to provide for ourselves, to provide for our families, to provide for ministry in the local church. If every one of us were to sell all our possessions and give away to the poor, and then come to follow Jesus, whatever that means, then we would not be taking care of what God has called us to do in terms of working and being productive that way. So I don't believe that when Jesus tells this man to sell his stuff, that same prescription applies to everybody. There's something going on in this fellow, and Jesus is speaking to that. So let's unpack then what Jesus is saying. What is going on in this passage? And the first thing to highlight here is the importance of both invitation and challenge. We see this in Jesus' words to him. He says to them first the words of challenge: sell everything you own and give it to the poor. And then the invitation: then come and follow me. Boy, when you get on the wavelength of looking for how Jesus gives invitations, how Jesus gives a challenge, these two things are the two pistons with which he makes disciples. He invites them to come close. "Come and follow me," he said. But then he gives them a whole new mission, a whole new reason, a whole new focus for their life. "Come and follow me. Be in deep relationship with me. and I will make you to become fishers of men and women and children for the kingdom of God. It is that 1-2 punch of the invitation and the challenge that made these disciples transformed into different people. It's this same thing that's going on here. Come and follow me, he said. But first, if that's going to happen, you're going to need to get rid of the thing that is holding you captive. So sell it all, give it to the poor. Then come and follow me. It's transformation. Had he done that, the man's life would have been transformed. Jesus often invites us into a deep, intimate connection with him. But then he gives us a whole new focus, a whole new challenge and reason for living. Remember that scene in the upper room where Jesus washes the disciples' feet? What an intimate connection he had with them. But then he turns and says, you know, I'm your teacher. I've given you an example. I want you to love and serve one another as I have done for you. Invitation and challenge. That 1-2 punch, it brings transformation. So that's the first thing to highlight here. Second, Jesus is uncompromising in his prescription in what he says to the man. He says, sell everything. And the sense of it is, and give it all to the poor. What we don't see in Jesus' words is deals. Man starts walking away and Jesus comes after him and says, whoa, I'm sorry. Instead of giving it all away, why don't you just give 50% of away? You can keep the rest of it yourself. 50% is too much? Well, how about 25? How about a tithe? Why don't you just give a tithe of what you own and give it to the poor? You can just keep the rest of it. We don't see that happen in Jesus. There's no compromise here. There's no pandering that happens. Jesus doesn't look at the guy and say, whoa, this dude's a heavy hitter. We got to keep him happy. So let's make sure that he comes along with us because he's got a lot of assets that we might need. So let's coddle this guy and keep him engaged and involved and keep him moving along with us. So let's, you know, sort of lower the bar in order to keep this guy on board with what's going on here. Jesus doesn't operate that way at all. He says to him, sell it all. Give everything away. And then come and follow me. We would do well to pay attention to Jesus' example here. And then there's also this thing that I discern as a reversal of a blessing. In that day and age, for someone to be wealthy, the culture would have regarded him as someone who was blessed by God. Because of his obedience, because of his leading a good and righteous and holy life, the Lord was pouring financial blessings into his life as a form of affirmation to him. That's how the culture would have regarded it, that this was a blessed man. And yet Jesus looks at this man whose pockets literally are bulging with gold. And what is Jesus' description of him? Jesus regarded the man as lacking, that he was poor, that he was missing something, that there was something absent from his life. Jesus takes what the world regards as a blessing and says, no. With what's going on in this man's heart and within his soul, this man is poor. He is lacking. And it helps me to understand what else it says in the New Testament about money. For the love of money is a root of all evil, Paul wrote to a young pastor named Timothy. That when there is a fixation on material things, money in particular in this particular verse, that there is an evil presence that is at work that is destroying this person's life. We know that the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And so as this man has come to believe that his life has gained value and weight because of his material possessions and his money, Jesus looks at that and says, no, this is an evil thing that has happened in this man's soul. And if you dial back just a step from the issue of money and come at it from the perspective of things that we all have a tendency in moments of weakness to grab a hold of something, I think it would be legitimate for us to be able to say, for the love of, and then fill in the blank. For the love of X is a root of all kinds of evil. For the love of anything that would compromise or dilute our love, our faithfulness, our commitment to the Lord, anything, a love of that thing would be a root of all kinds of evil in our lives. Fourth thing to highlight here, in love, Jesus has a hard conversation with the man. Did you hear what he said? Jesus looked at him in love and had those difficult words to say. And then, amazingly, I think in love, Jesus let him walk away. Because I don't think that man was ready to respond in a positive way to Jesus. And so Jesus allows him to continue down this path, hoping and believing and praying that he's going to come against a brick wall at some point in his life and then turn around and come back to the Lord. But in love, I wonder if sometimes God lets us, when we harden our heart to him, walk down a certain path until we get to a place where we say, ah, I need to return to the Lord. And clearly that man was not ready to do this, but in love, Jesus let him go. Jesus came to seek and save lost people, and he was ready to receive him when he would come. Five, Jesus points us to our legacy. And this is where we see this in verse 24. Remember, man walks away, Jesus addresses the disciples, and now in verse 24, Jesus addresses these kids. Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of heaven. It's as if he is looking at that man walking away and saying, see that guy? See how hard-hearted he is? If he is supposed to be somebody who is a mature spiritual mentor of the people of Israel, and he's behaving this way, Jesus would highlight, what is the legacy that is being left behind by somebody like that? What is our legacy? If Jesus were here today addressing the children who call this their spiritual home, what would Jesus be saying to them about those who are adults and mature in the faith, about what is happening in our own lives? What is our legacy? Is it one of selfishness, a fixation on money, the idolatry of screens? Let me park here for just a second. I read this recently, that across our culture, we see participation in civic organizations and spiritual organizations like churches, all on the decline. And one sociologist is saying, and what do we see on the incline, on the rise? The number of screens in people's houses. In fact, at some point, we reached a tipping point. And I know this is true in my house, that we probably have double the amount of screens in our home as we have people. And I'm talking about TV screens, computer screens, laptops, tablets, cell phones, and how many hours in the day do we spend before a screen? What is that saying to us? When we have said that participation in some of these civic organizations and spiritual organizations is on the decline, and yet on the rise is the use of these screens. Lastly, I would point to those question marks that are on, ironically enough, that TV screen. I think the Word of God is a living Word. As we have been speaking here today, that the Spirit of God might be bringing to mind something for you, some idolatrous, potentially idolatrous, some part of your set of behaviors that looks and smells a little bit like that. And that God would want you to be aware of that in your own soul. What is going on in you that would get in the way of you or me living as a faithful follower of Jesus? Because Jesus was having this hard conversation with this fellow about the role of money in his life because he had an idolatrous thing going on there. What is that for us? What is it for you, for me? Jesus points us to childlike faith, and that's why I think these two stories go together. Verse 15, before the man ever comes up to Jesus, Jesus says, I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. What do we know about how little children behave? They're trusting. They're dependent. They're very simple. They're not schemers. Are they sleeping, Brett? Little children often have that kind of innocence about them. It reminds me of a story, and I should have asked Joseph for permission for you to tell this story, but it comes from a time when you were about 5 years old. And we had some other kids from the church I was serving, the New Era Church at that time, over for a play date at the house. I think it was the Beckmans. And Danny was hanging out with you, and Jenny was hanging out with you, Grace. And it's interesting when 5 or 6 year olds have money, what their attitude is toward money, right? I've seen it happen before where at that age, they kind of treat money like it's a toy. They don't really understand or appreciate the sense of value that comes with that money. And so it's a toy. Let's get it out of the piggy bank. Your piggy bank opened at that time, unfortunately. Let's get it out of the piggy bank and play with it because it's a toy. And so a little bit later in that day, I see Danny Beckman walking around with a dollar in his hand. And I thought, well, this is kind of interesting. And I said, Danny, where'd you get that dollar? And he said, well, Joseph gave it to me. And then I looked at you, and Joseph goes, it's okay, Dad. I've already got one. As if the only thing a person would ever need is $1. If I've got an extra, sure, I can share that. There's a simplicity of spirit there, right? We receive God's blessings. And instead of hoarding them as if our lives somehow depended on the amount of money that we had, we hold it loosely. We give it freely. We share it out of a sense of, I love my friend. Why wouldn't I want to share with my friend? I think there's something about that childlike faith that Jesus calls us to here in this passage. All throughout Mark's gospel, we've been coming back around to our mission statement, helping people discover and follow Jesus. And as we grow in clarity on what that means and what that looks like when we are helping people, we're gathering people together as the family of God. We're growing them to be like Jesus. And then we're sending out people to live on mission with Jesus. And the sense that I have with regard to today's message is that we will be tempted, we will all be tempted, I'm including myself in this, to bring some sort of a golden calf along with us. And Jesus is saying, it's not helpful. You will be encumbered if you try to lug this giant golden calf of idolatry, whatever it is. Because in this guy, it happened to be money. But whatever that sense of idolatry is, if we try to lug that along, it's not going to go so well. And so one graphic I wanted to share with you is that I thought this is very insightful. The different idols that could be represented by our golden calf. Career, money, family, power, possessions, pleasure, self, entertainment, even religion, that is the behaviors that we do to try to make ourselves acceptable to God. Even that can become idolatrous. A focus on success or comfort. If we're going to be effective in helping people discover and follow Jesus, if we are going to gather and grow and go, we need to be unencumbered by the things that would be idolatrous for us. And so Jesus speaks his words to us. Because he loves us, Jesus says, one thing you lack. First, get rid of your, and it's your job to fill in the blank. Is the Spirit of God speaking to you today? One thing you lack. First, get rid of your, and then come and follow me. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you for this story. Thank you, Jesus, that you had this difficult, hard conversation with this man. Thank you that you saw the battle that was going on in his very own soul. And thank you, Jesus, that you came to be an idolatry warrior, to enter in, to call us to let go, so that we can more fully follow you. Jesus, thank you that you have not given up on us. Forgive us for our idolatry. Forgive us and make us new. Help us to follow you with our whole hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.